you're my brother, right?
No doubt.
You're getting down.
No doubt.
Word.
Word, I'm on the move, I'm going all out. You're my brother, right?
No doubt.
You getting down?
No doubt.
Word.
Word, the mother trigger, I'm going all out. What you think, nigga? You're my blood, my motherfucking heart. We was doing it back to back from the start.
It started from back to back, gat to gat. Now it's track to track.
So welcome. All you herds get done up, run up with your gun up.
All niggas get hung up. Jack,
set position.
Black suitcase, black fatigue. Strap,
gun holster, ready to toast ya and roast ya. Leave your clap.
Drop MCs like heart collapse, so dead that.
Well, I drop degrees and show you motherfuckers where our heads at.
We saw
who said that.
Ka-clap.
Underground anthem, pledge rap. Fuck with Saratoga, get your head cracked. Broken language, brother force, some other force.
Trigger the gambler, I'm my brother's keeper, that's why it ain't no double cross. Fake front and faggots, soft like fabric, I got gadgets, my craft go static. Pussy niggas get dramatic.
Dramatic, get niggas pussy static, cause craft, my gadgets got our fabric like soft faggots. Front and fake if you're backwards.
Any crews that refuse rules and regulations. Get reincarnated in tools on sets, niggas. I move with threats.
I move with bruised shit, mentally confused.
It's awesome. I'm out. So, what you're looking at now is a person named Dusé Mohamed. All right. So, he has a newspaper that he made called the African Times and Orient. If you look at our early MBK videos, you will see this. He also worked, Marcus Garvey originally worked for him. So he was one of his teachers. So now you're going to see this, these words here, Pan-Oriental, right? Look at the name of the paper, the African Times and Oriental Review. So this guy's supposed to be the first black person to write a book on Egypt, but it's not really historical. It's more like a dramatic type of story, but he wrote that. Then you will see it says his Pan-African Journal, and this is where Marcus Garvey meets him. He writes for him. He's one of his teachers. All right. It says in April 1922, he became a leading functionary in Garvey's movement and serving as the head of the African Affairs Department. So when you see this guy, you see this fez on his head. So once you see the fez, oh, he's more, he's this, that. Okay. So we want to know about this culture. Why were these black people doing this at this specific time? What happened? Why would he do it? Let's blow it up. I want to underline this. You need to look at this. Right here it says, while in the United States, Dusé used to wear a fez to protect himself from racism. What? How does the fez? Let me read that again. While in the United States, Dusé used to wear a fez to protect himself from racism. The act seems to suggest that despite the widespread prejudice against Islam and white America, it continued to be significant as a semi-civilizing and thus a liminal religion for African Americans. According to one of Dusé's biographers, there is no doubt that he was perfectly conscious that the exotic appearance identifying a black man as not a black American could give protection. As this to suggest black Americans' adoption of Islamic symbols and satire practices helped them escape to some degree the stigma of being black in white society. Thus, you have black means death. Do you understand this? Looking at
the code. I like that one, Rob. I like how you just did this.
Yes, put the cash app up, baby. We going in Black Friday.
I like how you did that one. Wait, hold on.
We going in. So
here you go, bro.
Yeah. So now check it out. It get deeper now. It said it gave them a liminal status of by disassociating them from the black stereotypes or de-negrofying them, thus allowing them to identify as a new race of Moorish Americans, members of the Nation of Islam. Testimonies by black converts of the Ahmadi movement in Islam also confirmed the role Islam played in their lives by ascribing to them liminal racial identity between white and black, which allowed them into white business establishment in the Jim Crow South. Come change your name, cried the prominent African-American convert who proselytized in the streets of St. Louis from the Ahmadi in the 1920s. Get back your original language and religion and you won't be a nigger no more. Do you understand what you just heard? Do you understand?
All right, so
I'm gonna let you take over. Now you gotta put the UN thing and then I'm gonna come
hold
back.
On. See, I'm out here. Hold on, brother. I'm out. I'm done. Okay. Boom. Boosie. See this guy right here? This is called Boosie. It's a cartoon. See? It's called Dark Laughter by a man named Ollie Harrington. And the main character is Boosie. Boosie and his homeboy are trying to get into the new joint called Nick's Barbecue. This is dark, but this is what this says right here. How are Boosie and his homeboys dressed? This is the fez. See the fez? One fez, two fez, three fez. And there goes the rest of the outfit. You see? And make it smaller so you can see it. There you go. That's what you're looking at. And you got one woman here, and there's another woman here, and this picture's cut off. I have the bigger picture somewhere. But it's more important. Let's see what they're doing. You see them laughing? That's Boosie and them other guys looking like United Nations folks. Boosie has on what? The fez and that Cape Charl thing. What are they doing? This is what they're asking in Harlem. Who are those people dressed like that running through Harlem? And what are they doing? So let's see. That's Boosie and them other guys looking like they called them folks, United Nations folks. Boosie says they can get in all the hotels and restaurants downtown because folks think they're foreigners. Well, they use foreigners, but boom. What did Rob Bond just read you? What is in the popular culture? How are the people dressing? Why are they dressing like that? What did I mention earlier about why we assume these things in different origins? Because the people were being treated differently. Think about what Rob Warren just read to you. With the fez in particular, and then we go to what was important. By the way, this is the Pittsburgh Courier, a black newspaper in 1947. And what's going on is plenty of Negro walking around like this. Why? Them UN folks get treated differently, can get into the hotels and restaurants because people think they're foreigners. Wow. I know Uncle Truth ain't just dude. Look at that, y'all. Ooh. Say what? I might have one more for you before you could go, Rob Bourne. So, yes, folks. A, like the video. If you haven't subbed and you're new, please sub to the video. Sub the channel. And with that, also support by, you know, what's on the screen, because Rob Bourne made me stay here. And he's going to come in here and try to battle. Like, I'm just going to let him start firing off. I'm just going to sit here and take this like I'm some Gump or something like that. It's going to walk like that. My friends are going to make sure that I eat and order me some Uber Eats. I'm going to sit up here and I'm going to take whatever you throw at me, son, and let you know. Set it, son. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid. Everybody. Who's that, Eminem? Wait, hold on 1 second. I'll give you the mic in 1 second, y'all. Hold on. I must got it somewhere else. I got something, and it talks about them being called United Nations niggas somewhere else. But anyway, in the meantime, between time, I should show you. Nah, I'm a whole lot. Don't be looking. Oh, y'all can't see it no more. I just saw the people in the hedge.
What? Something great, but I'm going to introduce you another follower of this that you may not have heard of before. So, one of Noble Juali's followers, Muhammad Azaladin, who was familiar with the Ahmadiyya movement, reportedly went to Cairo, Egypt in the early 1930s to study ancient Egyptian history and Islam. Upon his return to the United States, He traveled in the Midwest and the East Coast, proselytizing a version of Islam that combined the tenets of Sunni Islam with a myth of African-American origins, which identified Black Americans as Hamitic Arab people. According to Elsledan, through Islam, Black Americans could reclaim their Hamitic Arab identity and work collectively to improve the lot in life. Following the motto of the migration, Muhammad, who migrated from Mecca to Medina, Al-Zidane encouraged his followers to migrate from cities to establish agricultural communes where they could establish their own self-sufficient communities based on Islamic precepts. So regardless of this story this God told, he took that information, came here, and made these things happen. So then it says between 1938 and 1941, he and some of his followers found such a community called Jabul Arabia in rural West Valley, Carthage County, New York. Soon after its founding,
You don't just see that's your problem.
Yeah, let me stop.
You be too fast. No, you don't have to stop anything. You be too fast for your own good.
Go ahead. We're
gonna talk about something in 1941 named Jabul Arabia in upstate New York, and gonna just go past that. Like, oh, that sounds normal. That's not like what they got something called Jabul Arabia in upstate New York in 1941. You think that's just, oh, that's nothing?
No, it's not nothing. It's something, bro.
Okay, yeah. Oh, I was just curious. Go ahead, brother.
All right. So soon after its founding, Asiatic left West Valley for New Jersey, where he founded Ideologically, Universal Arabic Association, and established the Asiatic Village near Camden, New Jersey.
That's South Jersey.
He continued his missionary work in other regions. So I brought that to say this, right?
Mm-hmm.
These people made these things and studied these things, and for whatever reason, they attached this African origin to it, and they see the people that precedes them, which makes them understand how the game goes. But at the end of the day, regardless if they were benefiting from these things financially, they were helping Black people, and they built things. They built communities. They employed these communities. They build businesses for these communities. So these are the things besides playing around and pointing stuff out. That's kind of weird. The objective is to show how the hell you start talking about you were Asiatic. How you start talking about you were Hebrew. What does this have to do? How do you start doing magic? How do you start doing these shows? Why are you calling yourself a scientist? Why are you calling yourself an adept? It's all a part of the African-American culture. Deal with it. This is our culture. This is what we made here. So before you run off telling people they're pseudo, understand why these people did what they did. Drop the mic, the bomb, boom.
Okay, folks. So
what you got now? What you got? What you got now?
I'm just going to say, it's nice, right? It's cool. He dropped his little bomb, dropped the bomb here, right? He did that. But I'm now.
Let me show them the book. Hold on.
Go ahead, brother. Show whatever you want. Do you. Go in.
Here's the song right here. History of Islam in America. Mm-hmm. And then, oh yeah, the Ahmadiyya missionary Muhammad Sadiq to Garveyites. So now the Garveyites know about Mr. Muhammad Sadiq. What does that mean for them? What does that mean for these people? Well, let's keep on going down. I'm gonna get to this point, and then I'm just gonna end it. I just wanted to make sure that you can.
No, you gotta keep going, freak. Keep going.
Yeah, man. I'm gonna keep going. I just want to make sure they see these connections. So there's something that's
all during the Great Migration.
Yeah, I got to that.
Is this all when Caspar Holstein is around?
Yes.
What about Stephanie St. Clair?
Yes.
What about Madam C.J. Walker?
Yes.
Okay, keep going.
So a lot of these things happen around this exposition.
Oh, excuse me. I didn't mean to interrupt you. Is Noble Drew Ali around?
No.
Okay, what about Farah Muhammad?
No.
What about Elijah Muhammad?
No.
Okay, I didn't mean to interrupt you. Keep going.
Okay. It says, it is interesting to note that while Christians, as seen in the Columbian Exposition of 1893, this exposition is very important because this showcases the Middle East and all of these people are coming and this is the origin of your Shriners and they talking about they got these degrees from the Arabic
order. Excuse me, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I think I just show a picture of an Egyptian Shriner.
Yes, sir.
And I told you that he was at what? At the Chicago World Fair.
Yes, sir.
People at the Columbian Exposition, right?
I probably missed that, but yeah, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Yeah, can keep going. I just want to show all these people on national platforms doing this, and this is where they meet up to wield these things. But go ahead, brother.
That's right. So now it says something interesting here. Dusé Mohamed Ali cared little about the orthodoxy of the Ahmadiyya, as Mr. Danny was saying.
Here you go, son. Go ahead.
He said, the black man, the brown man, and the yellow man all have religions, traditions, institutions, and whatnot, which they love and admire. So for him, he saw that the African Islam was good for the African, not Americans, etc. So here's this guy here, Mutif Muhammad.
What do you have on his head there? Let me see.
No, yeah, but this is the Indian. This guy here, man. This
okay,
guy.
But what's on his head?
It's a turban.
Oh, okay. Hey, look at his face. Does he have a beard and a mustache like that?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, keep going. Is he Muslim?
Yes, he is.
With a beard and a mustache.
Right. So now okay. I want
you to not clear. Know why.
Right, no.
Okay, go. Okay.
Okay. So in the spring of 1922, Sadiq moved the headquarters of the Ahmadiyya from Detroit to Chicago. Pay attention to these cities and where you see later things rise. And later, with the help of the Army funds, what funds? Didn't we talk about the church and them fronts? Where is money coming from? Who's putting this in the community? Let's go. The Ahmadiyya funds from India established a mosque next to it and adorned with a dome. There is some evidence that suggests that Dusé was in Chicago around the same time. After moving his headquarters to Chicago, Sadiq became to lecture at NIA gatherings.
Wait a minute. Muslims, early Muslims, lecturing at UNIA gatherings. That's what you said?
That's what I said.
Could this lead to perhaps conversion of UNI people into Muslims? Let's just throw that out there. Maybe?
Yes, possible.
Okay, keep going.
And you just like jumped the gun, but it says, Sadiq began to lecture at UNIA gatherings and to convert Garveyites to Islam into Islam in significant.
Guess what? I just asked that question. Look what you did. Read that part again.
He converted significant numbers.
At so where? It says where? Be clear. Let's be clear, family. Read that and go all the way back up now.
Okay, what you want?
Go ahead. What was it in the spring of
1922?
Go ahead. Keep going.
Okay, it says at one time after five lectures at UNIA meetings in Detroit, here you go. Here go your temple right here. This is where he got the funds. This do look like some of them storefronts. They be on top of houses and stuff. He gained 40 new converts. Dusé and Sadiq were in Chicago and Detroit around the same time, but whether or not Dusé played a direct role in Sadiq adapting his message to a more Pan-Africanist audience is not known. What is clear, however, is that Richard Brent Turner has shown is that after moving his headquarters to Chicago in 1922 and given his success in converting members of the UNIA, Sadiq played greater emphasis on racial inequality in America and adopted more nationalist and presenting Islam as a solution to America's race problems. Allah, you Akbar.
Allah, you Akbar.
Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. I'm just trying to find this one thing.
Yo, that joint was hot on the brand new being joint, though, right?
Yeah. So he said, it says here, look at this. He also sought to boast his own respectability, printing copies of mail-ordered advanced degrees. He received... You heard me. Uh-huh. I wonder where we heard this story before. He also sought to boast his own respectability, printing copies of mail-order advanced degrees he received in such dubious fields as Orientalist sciences and mental science from some of the
fake correspondents. I got a question for you. What was Madame Blavatsky involved in?
The Theolastic Society.
Okay, was that like Oriental science-y stuff?
Oh, yes.
Uh-huh. How about DeLawrence?
Oh, my.
How about DeLawrence?
Yes, DeLawrence had correspondence courses.
Keep going.
Okay. It says, through his connection with the UNIA, Sadiq founded a community that not of the gentry, had the respect of average African-Americans within the community. He won not only converts, but also intelligent and enthusiastic persons whom he then appointed as leaders to varying congregations in the circles he visited. Consequently, his propaganda at times took on a more nationalist tone on the map of Islam to Garvey's Pan-Africanist project. The spread of al-Islam cannot help but benefit the UNIA, for they are desperately engaged in preparing for that day that we of the universal are also preparing for. Great Britain, France, Spain, in fact, all of the white powers fear Mohammedism. None of them can afford to offend al-Islam.
Is that hyping it up because we're in the midst of the world wars?
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
But let's let's get a little deeper on this, and then I'm gonna cut this. It says Islam, however, was not new to the UNIA. What? Really? Yeah.
Wait, what?
You heard? Uh huh.
Go ahead. Keep going. I ain't know that now. Keep going.
In addition to his association with Dusé, Garvey was thoroughly familiar with Blyden's book, Christianity, Islam, and the Negro Race.
Hold on now. That boy said, hold on now. Blyden.
Let's go.
Wait, hold on. So you're telling me Blyden was a Muslim?
No.
Oh. So what Blyden got to do with Islam? Keep going, Free.
Yeah, he doesn't go in on that here, but
I know you know.
Yeah, so he doesn't go in on it, but Blyden, you know, he visits the place. He talks about Africa. He saw how it was different from Christianity there. He saw how these...
Wait, excuse me. I didn't mean to interrupt you. He visited Africa?
That's right.
He just visited?
No, he was over there. He was doing something great there. You can tell.
Wait, hold on, you broke up. What?
I said you could tell him he was doing something great in West Africa. You can go.
Okay, no. I just want people to know it's more than Blyden visited
West
Africa.
Yeah.
Blyden damn near was a step away from running West Africa, although never elected to leader. I think he ran, what did he run? Twice? I think once in Liberia, and then he ran twice.
I think it was Liberia, but you gotta remember what happened. Dope. They tried to body that man, yo.
what he does is this connection to Islam, cousin. It's funny. It's kind of interesting that you pulled that quote, because now if you think about it, that was really something they was talking about, and that's how they used it to give it to us. Like, yo, Blyden said that Islam civilizes the West African savage better than Christianity, basically, right?
Yep.
And then I did a video early today on the religious instruction of the Negroes, and the same concept of how the Bible can be wielded to civilize these same West Africans. And you got a guy who is a Christian preacher pretty much writing this book. Like, it's so crazy to think about how all of this stuff really go with each other. So now we then fast forward a little bit, and Garvey got this book. Which one? The one on Ethiopianism?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and you have something called Garveyism that develops, yes?
Yep.
And Ethiopianism came out of that? Mm-hmm. Ethiopianism is first, and Garveyism comes out of that?
Yep.
Okay. Interesting. Go ahead, brother. What were you saying? Go ahead.
Keep going. Okay, so now, this is also interesting in the Garvey movement. It says the UNIA, like the Shriners, made regular use of Islamic terms the UNIA and the Shriners made regular use of Islamic terms and symbols. A UNIA musical composition made references to Allah, you Akbar. A UNIA musical composition made references to Allahu Akbar, and may he our rights proclaim in that most sacred name, Allah, one God, one aim, one destiny.
Wow. But hold on. But they yell from their know-it-all perches, Garvey wasn't Catholic. Garvey wasn't Catholic. Like, that's supposed to mean something when you don't understand the totality of what you just said. So now, in tonight, Friday night, because this is the crew, they ain't got nothing to do, although we seem to be doing a lot. Word to El Chapo. It's seeing that Islam also is playing a part. So hold on. When we clearly say that the UNIA was the organization to harness all of these varying migration cultures and people that are coming about, is that not self-evident? Do not the Christians hold on to UNIA? Do not the Hebrews, most of them, hold on to the UNIA? Do not the Muslims not hold Malcolm X parents was Garveyites, is what they say and yell.
Mm-hmm.
And now we see all these things connected to the man at the core of it, talking about what? Africa. My, oh my. Yes, keep going, brother. Right. Tell us about the Islamic UNIA.
So every time you hear that, right, you hear them point out who? Who's the person they point out that wrote the choir song?
Ford, they say, wrote the anthem.
Yo, Ford wrote the anthem. Well, wait a minute. What was this? Oh, yeah, you left that out.